God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about Mary. We talked about her, I believe, 2 or 3 weeks back. So we're going back to Bethany, and our case study is going to be Mary, the sister of Lazarus and Martha. And a short reading is Luke chapter 10, verse 38 to 42. It's really short, okay? Luke 10, 38 to 42. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Dear Redeemer Lord Jesus, we praise you. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, hallowed be your holy name. God in three persons, blessed Trinity, we honor you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for all you are. Thank you that you are God and you are good. Lord, speak your word into our hearts. Comfort us with your word. Strengthen us, O Lord, we pray. And let this word bring us up higher to the level you are challenging us to come up to. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. The title is Go for Gold Like Mary. Go for Gold Like Mary. And the foundation text is Luke chapter 10, verse 42. Luke 10, 42. But this is Jesus speaking now. One thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part, which will not be taken away from her. Now, Mary and Martha, like I said, they were sisters to Lazarus, and the family was very close to Jesus. So Jesus usually would go into their house whenever he was in Bethany, which is disciples. So on one of those occasions, Jesus was teaching and Mary sat at the feet of Jesus while Martha busied herself in the kitchen. And Martha came to Jesus and said, "Master, why can't you tell my sister to come help me?" And Jesus looked at Martha and said, "Martha, you busy yourself with the little things. Mary has chosen a good part." So we want to see, what did Mary do that made Jesus to give us such a beautiful commendation? The first thing she did, she sat. Here, Mary was position or place specific. Follow me. We are going somewhere, okay? Mary is teaching us that we need to be selective regarding where we have our intimate fellowship with God. I want you to underscore the word intimate. I put it there on purpose, because that's what it's meant to be. It's got to be intimate fellowship with Christ, okay? Geographical place matters. Mary moved away from her sister with whom she could be tempted to chat. If she had stayed around Martha, they would be chatting. You see, these were two ladies. She moved away from the kitchen, from where she could be carried away with the sight and the smell of food. Hello. I don't know about you, but may God help us, all right? So she moved away from that, from looking at food and smelling food, you see. We need to come aside into a solitary place as well. Jesus said to his disciples, come aside and rest. In Mark 6:31, Peter, when he was in Joppa, he went to the roof, the rooftop of the house where he was, in the house of Simon the Turner, you see, to pray. That's in Acts chapter 10, verse 9. Isaac went to meditate in the fields. That's in Genesis 24:63, you see. Nathanael was under the fig tree when Philip came to call him to take him to Jesus. What was he doing under the fig tree? He wasn't there counting figs on the tree. No, he was there meditating, having a fellowship with God. Jesus himself, our example, often secluded to fellowship with the Father, you see, and even the three closest disciples to him, he would not take them with himself on those occasions, you see. Sometimes early in the morning, sometimes late in the evening till nighttime. He would be somewhere on the mountain, he would be somewhere praying just by himself and meditating, talking to the Father. Mary went for gold in the area of her association to Jesus, you see. Whose company do you crave more? Your friends or the Lord's? Huh? Let's go to Exodus 33, verse 7a to c. And this Bible verse is almost hilarious, really. Moses took his tent and pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. If you know, if you're a Bible student, you will know why I said it's almost hilarious. Because by this time, the children of Israel, they've been doing so many crazy stuff. The golden calf, they've complained against God at the waters of Massa and Meribah. And each time God wanted to destroy them, and Moses will have to stay in between and say, God, please don't kill them, you see. So it's almost like Moses was like, you know what? I'm out of this place. You people are too crazy. He picked his tent and boom, went out of their midst somewhere. Bible scholars said it was like 2 miles away from the rest of them. If you wanted to see Moses, you have to walk that far to come meet him, you see. It's like, you are not helping me with my fellowship with God. And he loved his time with God so much, he moved out of the camp to leave them to their crazy making behaviors, you see. When you are in love with Jesus, come on now, you will want to be alone with Jesus. If you have ever been in love, when let's not go there. I was going to tell you a little bit about my courtship with my husband, but you know what? You don't want any of your friends around. When your fiance comes around, you don't want anybody because they are going to distract you. It's the same. When you are in love with Jesus, you will want to be alone with Jesus. Moving on. Mary not only sat, she stilled. Mary, listen up, was presence specific in this case. She was actively listening. She was there. I used to tell my student when I was a school teacher, be here, stay here, you see, because some would just sit there. Okay, miss, they are not there, you see. She was not absent-minded, when she sat beside Jesus, had Mary shown a strand of awareness concerning Martha's much serving, she could have been guilt-tripped into helping her sister, you see. Mary showed her heart focused on fellowship. As far as Mary was concerned, it's only Jesus and herself in the house. She couldn't see anybody, anyone else around. She was oblivious to all that. A present body, but an absent mind, is the same as not showing up at all. Some people will say, oh, I'm going to have a me time with Jesus, but they sit there, they are plotting what they are going to do, and you are not there. As far as God is concerned, you didn't show up. Oh, no. The leaders of Israel got a rebuke from the Lord for their absent-minded worship. That's in Ezekiel 33:32. Phone calls, text messaging, planning the next to-do list becomes, watch this, the devil's instrument if they can interfere with our fellowship with the Lord. And when I'm saying fellowship, I'm talking meditation. And the Holy Spirit asked me to say this. Meditation that we are talking about is not the one that you cross your legs and you close your eyes and you, no. There's no yoga in the Bible. It's from the pit of hell, okay? Some people, they say they do yoga in their church or in their fellowship. Just because they do it in your fellowship or your house church, it doesn't mean it's biblical. Yoga is not from the Word of God. So if you're a Christian and you participate in that kind of meditation, you are opening yourself up to demonic attacks. You are inviting demons into your body. So you want to stop that in Jesus' name. So what we are talking about here is Bible study. You see, you want God to speak to you. It's the time that God will speak to you through the Holy Spirit, from the Word of God, okay? Not from your head, from the Word of God. There's a wonderful pastor, I don't like dropping names, but he's very popular. He's an Asian pastor. And the story is told that the president of his country called him, and the secretary said, oh, sir, he's here, but you cannot talk to him. And he said, do you know who is on the phone? I want to talk to your boss. Sir, you can't talk to him. He's talking to somebody more important than you are. What? Well, cut a long story short, the secretary said, when the president of the country persisted, that who is he talking to? And he said, it's God. He's talking to God. And of course, the president quickly backed down. And he said, okay, when he's done with his meeting with God, please tell him to call me, you see. That man is known for his fellowship time with God, and nobody can pull him out of that place. That is the kind of life God wants us to live. Mary went for gold in the area of her attention to Jesus, you see. Not even her sister was able to pull her out of where she was listening, actively listening to Jesus. Acts chapter 3, verse 4, we stop at 5. The book of Acts chapter 3, verse 4 to 5. And fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, look at us. This was the story of the lame man. We did that a few weeks back. So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them, you see. When you go into your fellowship time with God, expect to receive something from the Word of God. So put your attention there. Our presence in His presence is the truth of our relationship in our fellowship with Him. I am going to rewind and say that slowly. our presence, your presence, my presence, in his presence is the truth of our relationship in our fellowship with him. Moving on. The third thing that Mary did that made her to go for gold, as far as Jesus was concerned, was that she savored. So she not only sat, she was not only still, but she savored. Mary was purpose specific. She took everything Jesus said in. How did we know that? Jesus saw that Mary understood his teachings. Our facial expressions and our thoughts, which were not hidden from the Lord's omniscience, made the Lord to tell Martha that Mary has chosen that good part, which cannot be taken away from her. You see, the Lord saw all that. We can't see that from the scripture. But Jesus saw that Mary indeed understood. And he told Martha, your sister has gone for the gold, you see. Mary's deep spiritual understanding and insight would show in the breaking of the alabaster box with which she anointed the feet of Jesus, according to John 12:3. We ought to be like Mary. We need to come to an intimate fellowship meeting prepared with writing materials. Come with your pen, or if you are using iPad or whatever eye they are using now, or your paper if you are like me, if you are very traditional like me, come with your notes, okay? Expecting to hear from the Lord. This will help us with remembering what we have learned in meditation. When it comes to the time to practice, when you write something down, there's a way it makes it stick to your memory more than just listening. I know some people, they call themselves auditory learners. But when you take both, you hear and you write, that you are doubly strengthening what you have learned, you see. The only way we can prove to God that we actually listened is by applying the lessons in our daily lives. God told Ezekiel, you will hear from me, and you will warn them for me. You see, that's a two-way transaction. That's in Ezekiel 33:7. Moses went up to meet with God with two tablets of stone in his hand. If he was not expecting God to say something that he was going to write, why would he go there with two tablets of stone? Huh? Mary went for gold in the area of her application of Jesus' teachings. That was how she prepared the body of Christ for the burial by anointing Jesus. Mary was not there on the mountain of transfiguration when Jesus transfigured in front of his three disciples. Mary was not there each time Jesus spoke to his disciples about his death. So how did she know to prepare the body of the Lord for the burial before the Lord died? How did she know that? Because she had been listening to Jesus, you see. Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 1, the prophet Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 1, I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart, that is on the tower. This is the prophet speaking. And watch to see what he, the Lord, will say to me, and what I will answer when I am corrected, you see, it's a two-way transaction. You see, Josephine Zion, how about prayer? Listen up. Prayer is you telling God what's going on with you. I don't know about you, but when I'm praying, I'm telling God what's wrong with me. Okay? I'm saying, God, I need help. So prayer is not what we are talking about here. Prayer has its place, but you cannot replace your Bible study discipleship time one-on-one with Jesus You cannot replace it with prayer. Oh no, it doesn't cut it. To apply divine instructions is to God's pleasure, but it's for our treasure. To apply divine instructions is to God's pleasure, but it's for our treasure. You never lose out applying biblical principles to any area of your life. Never. Now, we've talked about Mary. Let's quickly talk about Martha, because we also want to learn from her. So what did she do to make her earn a reprimand from Jesus? She strayed. That's what she did. Martha was distracted by much serving. She was performance specific, you see. Physical acts of good works become a danger to a believer's spiritual life when the physical takes more time and attention than the spiritual. Martha got in trouble, just as Simon Peter got in trouble, by not being mindful of spiritual things, you see. Jesus said, "Get thee behind me, Satan," to Peter. He said, "Because you are not mindful of the things of the Spirit," you see. Believers, listen up, please. Believers live in two opposing worlds. We belong to two worlds, folks, if you're a child of God. We live in the physical, material world. This, you know, the natural one, where you're looking at me. But we operate from the heavenly, spiritual world, from where we control the natural world using our spiritual weapons of warfare, which are not carnal, but mighty through God, you see. That's according to 2 Corinthians 10:4. So that's why if you are a Christian, that you don't have time for one-on-one with Jesus, you will be a powerless Christian. Because your war strategy is given to you in your intimate time with Christ. You will be able to apply biblical principles to natural problems and they will be solved. But when you neglect spiritual area, you become powerless. A Martha Christian sees before believing. They are bankrupt on faith, and that is why they cannot please God. Because the Bible says, without faith, you cannot please God, you see. That is the currency that we spend in the kingdom of God, faith. That's Hebrews 11:6. To please God, we need to walk with God like Enoch. The Bible says, Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. You see, he was translated. He didn't die. He was translated. That's how much he walked with God. That's in Genesis 5:24. God created us first and foremost for fellowship. Genesis 3:8. God will come down in the cool of the day, in the evening time, to come and talk with Adam and Eve, you see, for fellowship. If God had wanted us primarily for service, he wouldn't have created innumerable company of angels who have been serving him before we were created, you see. So for all of you that go, "Oh, I'm doing something for God, I'm doing something great," we thank God for that. But God didn't create you first for service. He created you for fellowship. The first angel assignment was in Genesis chapter 3, verse 24. So that will tell you that angels have been serving God before we got here. Martha got the flag from Jesus, not because she was serving. No, do not get Josephine Zion wrong. I did not say stop serving God. I did not say that. The Bible doesn't teach us that. But she got in trouble because she ignored the gold of one-on-one Bible study with Jesus for the bronze of service. That's the problem with Martha. This principle has not changed. Jesus said to the disciples, "I still have many things to say to you," in John 16:12. Guess what? Guess what? The Holy Spirit is still saying the same thing, that I have so many things to tell you about your family, about your bloodline, about your job, about your children. I have so many things to tell you. Whatever you do at the expense of your fellowship with God will be burned up. Let me say that again. Whatever you do at the expense of your fellowship with God will be burned up. A loss of reward when we get to the Bema seat of Christ. So don't think you are doing this and, oh yeah, my crown in heaven is going to be huge. If you are doing that at the expense of your discipleship, one-on-one Bible study with the Holy Spirit, if you are doing whatever you are doing in the house of God, in the vineyard of God, you pray for 3 hours, but you cannot study one-on-one Bible study with the Holy Spirit for 30 minutes, listen up. It's not going to be burned up because your priority is out of whack. Your fellowship with God is the most important thing to the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27. I'm going to read from English Standard Version. 1 Corinthians 9, 27. Listen up. This is the Apostle Paul speaking by the Holy Spirit. And a lot of people have misinterpreted this Bible verse so many times. But I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. And they go, whoop. Oh, that's Paul saying he doesn't want to lose his salvation. That's not what he's saying. Where did you get that? Huh? You see, that's why you need to stay one-on-one with the Holy Spirit to learn the Bible from the Holy Spirit. Don't let anybody tell you what the Bible is saying. Don't let me tell you what the Bible is saying. The Holy Spirit is our teacher. Let him teach you. What Apostle Paul is saying is, I don't want to miss the prize when I get to heaven. I don't want to lose my reward. Because if he continues preaching and telling people about Jesus, but he himself doesn't have time to sit with the Holy Spirit one-on-one, guess what? He's going to lose his reward. That's what he's saying. It's the same thing. Whatever you're doing, if it's at the expense of your personal, intimate Bible study with the Holy Spirit, you are going to lose the reward. But that can change. For the sake of his name in you, he wants to train you to retain his gain in you. That is so beautiful, isn't it? Let's say that again. For the sake of his name in you, he wants to train you to retain his gain in you. Jesus said, "In this my Father is glorified, when you bear much more fruit." That's what it's all about. So, what made Jesus to commend Mary? Number one, she sat. She separated herself from distractions to be alone with Jesus. Number two, she stilled. She was actively listening to Jesus. Number three, she savored. She practiced what she's learned from Jesus' teachings. What made Martha to be reprimanded by Jesus? She strayed. She took physical works more seriously than personal one-on-one discipleship with Jesus. Now, if you are a genuine believer, you're confident your sin has been washed away, are you a Mary or a Martha Christian? Huh? Which one are you? Our faith walk is first of fellowship, then of function. Martha Christians, repent. Repent. The Lord wants you to be having personal Bible study with Him. This is discipleship with the Holy Spirit as the teacher. It is a good part which no one can take away from you when you get that good part. No pastor will mumble jumble you. No fake prophet will be able to stand before you. When you don't let anybody tell you what is in this Bible, like Francis Chan said, are you an unbeliever? The Bible says, listen up, listen to what your spiritual bio bearer by the Holy Spirit from the Bible. If you are an unbeliever, the Bible says you are spiritually dead, you are blind, and you are headed for the lake of fire. That's not good, is it? But that can change. Because Jesus loved you, and that's why He died for you. Now, if you would like to examine the claims of Christianity, and you are ready to follow the evidence to wherever it leads you, a link is coming up. Follow that link. Father God, we ask that you help us, that we will not take lightly our discipleship with you. We will not replace our one-on-one Bible study with physical stuff. Help us, Holy Spirit. Take us deeper in your word. In Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.